As the world ushered in the 21st century, the demands of a modern, top-class sporting event kept the eyes of the Wimbledon organisers fixed firmly on the horizon. Physical changes were afoot, most notably the handsome new Millennium Building, which, although state-of-the-art, fitted seamlessly into its elegant surroundings. Wimbledon was still unmistakably Wimbledon, as innovation and tradition continued to stroll companionably hand in hand at the All England Club. But as always at Wimbledon, there was a respectful nod to the past. The Millennium Championships parade of past champions on the middle Saturday proved that for a few, time can stand still. The centre court crowd rose as one to welcome back the players that had immortalised the tournament. And there was a long overdue welcome for one of its favourite songs.
He's back on centre court today for the first time since 1981. Show him how much we've missed him. It's Bjorn Borg.
Perhaps only then did Borg understand how much he had truly missed the game and how much the game had missed him. But the first decade of the new millennium would be synonymous with an entirely new generation, each of whom had yet to inscribe their names on the Wimbledon Roll of Honour. In this, the final part of our series, we take a look at the first decade of a brand new century, which would showcase dominance in both the men's and women's games in a way never witnessed before. But as always, Wimbledon would also provide a fitting backdrop for the stuff that dreams are made of, often from a most unexpected source. But initially, at least, there was one story still to reach its natural conclusion. Not since the halcyon days of Borg himself had one man been so utterly dominant of centre court. Pete Sampras came into the new century bidding to win his seventh singles title, a record and marker of such enormity that even the American had difficulty putting it to the back of his mind.
I'd be lying to you if I said I didn't think about it. Sure, I thought about it constantly, about if it was going to happen here. Just kind of the drama and the build-up from the match.
The occasion demanded drama, and the greatest stage in the sport complied as the usually nerveless Sampras made uncharacteristic errors early on.
Well, who would have believed it? Successive double faults from Sampras, and Rafter wins the first set.
But Sampras wasn't about to let the situation get away from him. There was simply too much at stake. Having leveled, he then assumed command.
I knew it was getting dark. You look at the clock, it was 9 o'clock, and that's pretty much way past the usual stuff, about 8:30. Who would want to come out the next day and finish it?
Game, set, and match. Sampras.
You know, fortunately, things just kind of worked out well for me there. It was kind of a perfect ending to the record, the way it ended that night, and it was just kind of one of those surreal moments that I've witnessed many times, but to be a part of it was very cool.
The sight of the usually impassive Sampras in near darkness climbing into the stands to embrace his parents as flashbulbs pierced the gathering gloom provided a suitably theatrical ending to the Millennium Fortnight. But in any sport, a champion's invincibility is fleeting, a snapshot of an era. It takes a brave man to walk away when his powers are at their greatest. All too often, the king is humbled by a pretender to the throne. Roger Federer was 11 years old when Sampras won his first Wimbledon title. But the talented teenager, with a tantalizing array of shots, showed composure beyond his years in his very first match on center court.
Like, so many people watched it on TV, so many people were happy for me, even though they were sad for Sampras, you know. But maybe they felt like somebody new was arriving and that I could then fulfill, also live up to the expectations a couple of years later was unbelievable.
The center court is a place where dreams are made and shattered. And in 2001, there was a fairy tale in the making. But the heroic knight at its center was a battle-scarred Croatian who had failed to lift the trophy on each of his three previous final appearances.
So many guys took the first chance or second chance, and I get three chances, and I couldn't take it. So I thought, must be something wrong with me, you know, and probably I'm never gonna get another chance.
His appearance in the last 16 was deemed a bit of a fluke, the final gallant switch of Goran's topsy-turvy career. But the aces kept flowing. The tide kept rising, and it seemed only one outcome was possible. That year, the world of Wimbledon was slightly out of kilter. When Goran walked out to center court for his fourth final, it was on the third Monday of the championships, christened People's Monday, in front of a 10,000-strong crowd that had queued for tickets on a first-come, first-served basis.
I don't think it's gonna ever be that kind of atmosphere, you know, because it was Monday. They let so many tickets for the normal people. The atmosphere was like not on tennis, like on the football game. So, but that time I said, listen, this is another chance, and this time if you don't win it, I don't know, probably I kill myself there.
See what it meant to him, to just see that his whole body shuddering with emotion on that particular day, that here was a guy who really felt, probably when he walked out the year before in the Champions Parade, that he felt as though he didn't belong. And a year on from that, there he is lifting the men's singles title.
I was the committee member who was given the responsibility of taking Goran for his post-match interview.
Everyone would like to raise their glasses to Goran. On a fantastic day.
And I remember one of the reporters asking Goran the question, you know, what happens next? You've now fulfilled your dream, you've won Wimbledon. And he came out with this now quite famous saying of,
my dreams came true, and whatever I do in my life, whatever I go, whatever, I'm going to always be Wimbledon champion.
The first decade of the new century proved a productive one for the women's game as well, or at least for one family. The Williams sisters, Venus and Serena, emerged from the city of Compton on the south side of Los Angeles to dominate the women's game. They changed perceptions about who could play the game and how it could be played. When Venus won the first of her singles titles in 2000, beating her younger sister in the semi-final, the first of many encounters at Wimbledon, it signified the start of a stranglehold on the Venus Rosewater dish that would run and run.
It's so cool to be part of Wimbledon history. It's just, you know, if there's going to be a slam that you do well at, you got to choose Wimbledon. That's been my choice. And immediately I get more pep in my step and hitting better and running faster and serving bigger. My dad always told us to pick a slam that we wanted to win more than anyone else, and so I picked Wimbledon.
At the end of the 2010 championships, the sisters had held the trophy aloft an amazing 9 times, and only one final had failed to feature a Williams.
You think of Wimbledon, you think of classic, you think of history, and it's always a buzz every time I walk in there. It's just, there's a whole new spirit. I honestly feel that spirit at every Grand Slam. I just really enjoy playing it, and I enjoy getting there and just being part of something super special.
Sibling rivalry reached a whole new level. The Williams family, the ultimate winners. And the women's game was changed forever.
But the first time when I saw Venus in France, you know, like you are admiring ballet dancers. When I saw few shots which she was hitting, I knew she was special. I knew she's something which is incredible. And every time when they're at the tournament has a different level. But you still have to have this kind of stamina inside of you, which will allow you to not to be afraid to be number one. And I think both of the sisters like that. They're not afraid to be on the top of the whole game.
But at the same time, a new power was emerging in the wings. Eastern Europe produced a stream of top-class players through the first decade of the century, many of them products of the tennis academies of Florida. By 2009, five of the top 10 seeds in the women's singles draw were Russian. The Cold War in tennis dresses? At times, the Williams sisters must have felt overwhelmed by the sheer weight of numbers.
Well, I think when the Soviet Union broke up into its various satellite countries, there was a freedom overcame lots of these nations, and sport is a way to express your desire for freedom. And I think a lot of parents in those countries saw sport as a means that their kids could blossom.
Well, when I went, it was national coach. I mean, I was selected from 15 countries. It was good, it was difficult, it was tough, it was pressure. I mean, I had a great opportunity to choose all of these good girls, to put them together and prepare them the way I thought they had to do. And the money, it was a way out. I mean, the way out to the better life.
Born in Siberia, coached in America, Maria Sharapova came to Wimbledon as a promising starlet. She hit the ball like a missile and with almost as many decibels. But the general consensus was that 17-year-old's time was yet to come. Who knew that beneath the almost fragile-looking exterior was a core of pure steel?
Niamh Bolitere came to me and was saying, you're supposed to look at this great girl. I saw that fighting spirit which she had, incredible. But of course, when Maria came here and won Wimbledon, I think it was a little bit shock for everybody. Because we all knew about Dementieva, Myskina, and we knew that Masha is coming up. We knew she's talented, but we didn't know that she will do it so quick. It was incredible.
I mean, even though I had so much attention from whatever, from the quarterfinals on, you know, to me, whenever I stepped on that court, everything was blocked. I didn't hear anything. I didn't hear any voices. I don't remember what people said. It was just concentrating on myself and the ball, and that's it. And it's really amazing.
The Russian teenager produced the performance of a lifetime to win the title, the trophy, and the hearts of the millions watching at home. The very first television broadcast from Wimbledon was in 1937, and it still remains the principal way that most people enjoy the tournament. But the huge leaps forward in technology have meant that the nature of the broadcast is rapidly changing.
Radio first started here way back almost at the turn of the century, which was the first broadcast iteration of Wimbledon. We were probably most notably the first live colour broadcast in the United Kingdom. The notion that what you'd been watching originally was black and white, no chance of the vivid green of the grass and so on, suddenly being converted into color was fantastic. And in many ways, that's what kickstarted the developments. And two or three years ago, of course, we became a fully high definition tournament, one of the first to do that. And this year, on our 125th, we'll of course be doing 3D coverage from center court of the final stages of the tournament for the very first time.
We have got a number of broadcasters fighting over our rights, and what we seek is to try and find, not surprisingly, the best financial deal, but also the deal that gives us the best coverage in terms of reaching the most people within that territory that we possibly can. I think the whole intention really is to make sure that we reach all audiences wherever they are and how they can view us.
The net clearly is where it's at. It's a very difficult beast. It's a different beast for those of us who come from a particular background and those of us of my age, frankly. We're learning new techniques and we're learning how it should be done. But actually, it's where significantly more people every year are getting their Wimbledon coverage and Wimbledon information from, and we really have to be alongside that, if not leading it sooner or later.
Wimbledon's official supplier of information technology is IBM, a relationship that began modestly with graphics for the BBC in 1990 before evolving into the state-of-the-art system that it is today.
The first year that the public were involved outside of the BBC graphics statistics was 1996, when IBM created the official website. In 1999, it was the first year that we did an on-site system for the public, players and press, which gave detailed and real-time statistics as each match was progressing on the show courts. And over the years since then, we've expanded that out to not just show courts, but actually every single court that's in play at Wimbledon. So for every score that's played on court, the chair umpire records what's happened. That data flows back to the IBM scoring system and is sent out over an internet link to our three data centres, where it's then pushed out to the millions of people who are watching the website live in real time. And for that chain of events to happen is actually sub-second. So very often you'll be watching on the website, you'll see the score updated before the umpire has a chance to call it on court, because he's waiting for the applause to die down.
Wimbledon is a tournament that has thrived on rivalries. Incredible finals that have staked a claim for the title Best Match Ever. Borg McEnroe, Navratilova Evert, Becker Edberg. But the class of 2008 was extra special. When Roger Federer walked from the dressing room on the final Sunday, he was aiming for a record-breaking sixth consecutive title. But it was by no means a foregone conclusion. Rafael Nadal, the dynamic Spaniard, had honed his grass court game to near perfection, and a mouth-watering clash awaited the centre court crowd. Finally, here was a player deemed a worthy opponent to the mercurial Swiss. His five previous titles were an achievement of almost mythical proportions, but had rarely seemed in doubt. Such was Federer's utter dominance on the grass.
Having won five in a row, for me, it's an absolute dream come true. It's almost disbelief still to some degree. People see me in a different way. When they see me play, they have the feeling they're seeing, you know, history at work, you know. It's different now than before. Times have definitely changed now.
There was a sense that that match, right from the word go, it was going to be a very special occasion.
If you were going to map out, you know, when is tennis at its peak, it's when the two best players who have this rivalry face each other in the final match of the great tournament, Wimbledon.
Just 12 months earlier, Federer had equaled Borg's record of five titles on the bounce. In 1981, McEnroe, a flash left-hander, had finally prevailed against the cool Swede. And the comparisons with this match were the stuff that journalists' dreams were made of. Nadal's firepower had found its range, and the reigning champion appeared shell-shocked. 90 minutes into the match, and Federer was staring down the barrel of a two-set deficit.
Federer comes out in the second set, gets an early lead, and Nadal sort of storms back. And you really thought that the way that second set went, in this set, Federer had it and blew it. What does this guy really have left for the rest of the day?
You put yourself in Nadal's shoes. You're playing the player who is the king of Wimbledon at that stage. You're two sets of love up in the final. Now, you try and imagine how mentally he must be feeling. If I win the next set, I'm the champion, but can I possibly keep up this standard of play that I've had for sets one and two? Well, maybe I can, but somehow Roger's got to be Roger in a minute.
Federer challenged the corner left, baseline, ball was called out.
To the relief of the crowd, Federer's pinpoint accuracy had returned, although it took the electronic brain of Hawkeye to confirm it. Ironic, since the world number one had made no secret of his distaste for an innovation he deemed an affront to sport's moral code, but which was now a fixture on tennis courts the world over.
I think any technology who can improve the game, I think is welcome. I think it's very good. Because it's micromillimeters we're talking about, you know, decision in or out.
Essentially, we set up five cameras for each end. These cameras are sort of set up, focused on the that half of the court. And then essentially they work individually with a PC to track the ball in relation to the line in just in two dimensions. And then all that information is then fed to a control machine, which sort of acts as the sort of brain of the operation, where it just puts everything together. Then once everything's mapped together, it's put into a small file with just the simple tracks of the ball, where the player's gone. And then again, that falls to the virtual reality side of it, which is what everyone sees at home, which is sort of the pretty end of the system, which lets you see whether the ball's in or out. And the level of error of a line call is and does roughly equate to about 3.6 millimeters, which is roughly about the size of the fluff on the ball.
Hawkeye shows how good the line span are. You know, this if you see, they are the play's only 30% right, and the rest is 25 to 30% right. I think it shows, Hawkeye shows how good the official are.
The titanic struggle continued, the spectators spellbound and the play sublime. As the Federer comeback continued in the fourth set, this match promised to be the equivalent of Borg-McEnroe for the digital generation.
It wasn't until, really to me, the fourth set that people said, wait a second, this is a special match. It's going to be the final match on center court before the roof comes up. It's one versus two. It's Federer sort of proudly trying to keep his territory versus Nadal, the attacker, trying to really make his mark. Remember, they played a great final the previous year. Nadal had never won Wimbledon. There's so much going on.
The fourth set was just tremendous tennis again, and spellbinding. I mean, tie breaks in it as well, and just the levels that Roger found.
The momentum appeared to be with the five-time champion, but Nadal was never going to lie down. His break in the 15th game of the final set proved decisive.
Game, second half. Nadal, 3-7-2, 6-4.
That celebration, I think, alongside Ivanisevic in 2001, those are the two that stand out through the sheer joy and the sheer emotion, and it coursing through their entire body.
Amazing feeling, no, for me when here in Wimbledon on grass. For any Spanish, it's very tough, but for me it's a dream. No, I always dream about win here any day, and well, right now I have the title, so very emotional for me.
I think if you sort of look at all the components of this match, the quality of play, the swinging momentum, one versus two, everything on the line, I think it's going to be hard to replicate Federer-Nadal of 2008.
The following year, Federer contested another epic match, but this time the valiant Andy Roddick provided the opposition. It was the third time the two men had contested a Wimbledon final, and it seemed as though the luck might this time be on the American side. But in the longest fifth set of a men's final in the history of the championships, Federer clung on to win 16-14, securing his sixth Wimbledon crown and a record 15th Grand Slam singles title.
I had my first win here in 2003. I had a win here as a junior. I beat Sampras here in 2001, and then, you know, the rest is history. And I've had so much success here, and it's a tournament I love most. You know, I love coming here. It's such an honor to be a member of the club, and I hope I can do it again.
But the duration of that final set would pale into insignificance just the following year, when a first-round match between Nicolas Mahu and John Isner broke every record in the book. The two combatants spent 11 hours and 5 minutes over 3 days slugging it out on court 18. Even the scoreboard struggled to cope with the ever-rising numbers. But eventually it was the young American who prevailed, 70 games to 68. Isner and Mahu, some names are destined to be forever entwined. Rafael Nadal, along with Serena Williams, will defend his title in the 125th Championships. The first organisers of the tournament would marvel now at the rich heritage they created, at the size, scope and luxury of the modern championships. But the beauty of the game, the aesthetic quality of the surroundings and the athleticism of the players would be easily recognisable a century and a quarter after Wimbledon's tentative beginnings. It is the want of variety that will prevent lawn tennis from taking rank among our great games, wrote Spencer Gore. 125 years on, Wimbledon's first champion might be forced to revise his opinion. This is a tournament that means so much to so many.
Wimbledon is very different to any other tournament on this planet.
Wimbledon is like a peak where you're trying to get in, you know? It's something like it's a star in the sky.
Unique.
Magic.
Pure.
Green. Amazing.
Special.
Tradition.